A lot of people, they want to receive God's blessings without putting in any work for those blessings. They want to receive God's blessings without letting go of that slavery mindset that is preventing the blessings, without letting go of those emotional attachments that is preventing blessings, without letting go of the ways of this world that is just does not allow God's blessings to come in, without going through a testing period, without going through a training period, without going through a purging period, a purging where you have to let go of the old, because guess what? Because those old are what is keeping you stuck in your old ways and preventing you from moving forward with God in the ways of God. You see, God is not going to bless sin. God blesses your new spiritual life with Jesus Christ. God doesn't bless sin. You see, this is why it's so important that we have to accept first, we have to accept Jesus Christ into our lives, into our hearts as our Lord and Savior. What does it mean, Lord and Savior? Let's start there. Well, let's start with Savior. We're all living in sin, whether we know it or not, whether we like it or not, we are all living in sin in some way, shape or form. It could be a sin of drug addiction. It could be a sin of fornication. It could be a sin of masturbation. It could be a sin of gluttony, overindulgence. It could be a sin of lying, a sin of stealing, a sin of hate, a sin of jealousy, a sin of covetousness, wanting what the other person has. All these things are sin, but it's not just the things that you're doing. Sin can also be things that you're not doing. For example, God says love your neighbor, but you don't. You just love yourself. God says feed the homeless, shelter the feed the hungry, shelter the homeless, clothe the naked, but you don't. You just turn a blind eye and you're just selfish about yourself. God says love the Lord your God with all your heart, but you don't. You love Netflix, you love social media, you love your own entertainments more. You know, God says treat others how you want to be treated, but you don't. You expect others to treat you with respect, but you're disrespectful to others. So it's not just what you do that is sin, it's also what you don't do. Anything you do that goes against the word of God is a sin. Let's just put it that way. Anything that you do goes against the word of God is a sin. So you're living in sin. God's not going to bless that. A lot of people say, why is God not blessing me? Why is not God helping me? God doesn't bless sin. He does not bless it. Why is God going to bless sin? If God blesses sin, he's going to go against his own word. That makes God a liar. God is not a liar. It's not in his nature to lie. Satan is the liar. He's the father of lies, and the Bible tells us that. So we need the Savior. Jesus Christ comes in. We accept Jesus Christ into our hearts as our Savior. In other words, this means that you say, you know what? Whether you say it out loud, whether you say it in your heart, it means you say, you know what, Jesus, I've had enough of my ways. I've had enough of living in the ways of this world. I've had enough of living in the ways of my own carnal mind, the slavery mind. I've had enough of living in my own fleshy nature. It's all about me. It's all about drunkenness. It's all about fornication. It's all about pride. It's all about selfish ambition. You know, the ways of the flesh, the ways the world teaches. You say, I've had enough of that, and I want to give my life to Christ. Giving your life to Christ means that you want to let go of all of that, and you want to walk in a way that is right in God's eyes. You want to walk in a way, you want to walk in the ways that Jesus Christ walked. That's what giving your life to Christ means. You walk in the ways of Jesus. What were the ways of Jesus? The ways of Jesus always pointed to God the Father. And so God won't bless you when you're living in sin. So when you invite Jesus into your heart as your Savior, it's like you're saying to him, you know, it's like you're saying, I know I'm living in sin and I need you to come and save me from that sin. That's a Savior. With those sins, carrying those sins around with you ain't going to get you into heaven. I'm going to be blatant. I'm going to tell you the truth. It gets you into hell. If you don't believe in that, Satan's already deceiving you. And so Jesus Christ comes in as the Savior. Savior from what? Savior from those sins. It saves you from your sins. It saves you from hell. Brings you into the kingdom of God. And so that's what it means by a Savior. What does it mean by Jesus being your Lord? Jesus being your Lord means he comes in and he takes lordship over everything. When Jesus takes lordship over everything, it means that nothing else can be Lord have lordship over your life. There can't be two lords in your life. So if Jesus takes lordship over your life, depression can't be lordship over your life. Addiction can't be lordship over your life. Fornication can't be lordship over your life. The anger that you're dealing with can't be lordship over your life. Guess what? Jesus, depression, anxiety, oppression, none of that can be lordship. Poverty, none of that can be lordship over your life. Guess what? Because Jesus has come in and has taken lordship over everything. That's why you need him to be your Lord and Savior. When you accept Jesus Christ into your heart as your Lord and Savior, he comes to reside in your heart with the Holy Spirit, Jesus and the Holy Spirit being one of the same. Come to reside in your heart. And day by day, bit by bit, the Holy Spirit starts to convict you. What does that mean? It starts to convict you of your wrongdoings. You see, Jesus has already saved you of those sins. You're no longer going to pay the price of those sins. Jesus has already taken them. You've already been forgiven. But the Holy Spirit convicts you to try to change your mind and your heart and everything about you, so you don't go and fall into the same sins that Jesus saved you from. So just because Jesus has forgiven you those sins and saved you from them, he's got to break away the mindset now that got you in that to begin with. He's got to break away this mindset, and you call it the carnal mind, the slavery mindset. He's got to break away that mindset of you, so you don't get into the same things that he saved you from. So someone could be a drug addict, let's say, and he invites Jesus into his heart as his Lord and Savior. So now Jesus comes in, you've already been forgiven of that sin and all the things that you've ever committed. But if you don't break the mindset, the slavery mindset, you're still going to be slave to drugs. So you're still going to continue in this manner. And this is why you need to allow Jesus to take lordship. Every day the Holy Spirit is going to convict you of your wrongdoing. Look, this is what you're doing. This is the bad thing that you're doing. It's going to convict you. And then you need, through faith in Jesus Christ, to start breaking away those bad habits, those bad mindsets. You see, remember, God's not going to bless sin. You're wondering, well, why is not God not blessing me? Why is he not blessing me? Because in your heart or in your mind or in your home, there is still sin somewhere. Somewhere there's still sin. God does not bless sin. So the Holy Spirit convicts you. You want to be happy when the Holy Spirit convicts you. Convicts you means Holy Spirit is bringing it to your awareness. It's making you conscious of it. And there's conscience. You've got conscience. Oh, this is wrong. I shouldn't be doing this. And you say, yeah, but I can't help myself. I can't control it. It's not you that's going to help yourself. And it's not you that's going to control it. It's the power of the Holy Spirit in you that's going to help you. That's going to help you control it. The Bible tells us in Galatians chapter 5, verses 22 to 23, one of the fruits of the Holy Spirit is self-control. So you have to not work with the, let's say it's a drug addiction. You have to you're not going to start working with a drug addiction. You're not going to start fighting against the drug addiction to help you with that problem. You're going to start working with the Holy Spirit. A lot of these drug treatment programs out there, they focus on the drug problem. They focus on the, let's attack the problem. Let's fight with this issue here. It's not about that. It's about your focus being on the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit, working with the Holy Spirit, because the Holy Spirit in you is going to strengthen you and start to produce fruits of its nature. What are the fruits of the Holy Spirit? It tells you in Galatians, it tells you it's love, gentleness, kindness, patience. One of those fruits of the Holy Spirit is self-control. It is the Holy Spirit in you who's going to produce its fruits in you. Once you produce the fruits, which is self-control in you, you can control that drug problem. But all these drug treatment programs out there, and I know about that because I used to be addicted to drugs many years ago. And you can find that in my book. My testimony is in there as well. And you can get that on Amazon, paperback and Kindle. And it's all about focusing on the problem. And it's all about focusing on how you feel. And it's all about focusing on it's all about the problem. It's not you that's going to deal with the problem. It's the Holy Spirit in you that's going to deal with the problem. And so once you start walking in the ways of God, In the Holy Spirit will only come through Jesus Christ. And once you start walking in the ways of God and you start breaking away these mindsets that's keeping you in those bad relationships, in that poverty, in that drug, in that anger, in that whatever it is that you're going through. Holy Spirit convicts you every day. This is what you're doing wrong. This is what you need to change. He might show you that you're prideful. He might show you that you're immature. He might show you that you're angry. He might, and then he starts to bring it to your awareness more and more, and so it's going to start to become blatant, and then you're going to just go into start realizing it before you're doing it. Say for example, you're dealing with anger, you're going to start feeling it boiling up before you start lashing out. So the Holy Spirit is giving you, is working with you here. So before you would lash out without even realizing it, but now the Holy Spirit is convicting you, showing you what you're doing, and then it starts working with you if you willingly show an interest, because you have free will. If you willingly show an interest to deal with that problem, because the Holy Spirit convicts people, and a lot of people brush it off and they say, I don't have time to work with that now. I want to keep this bad habit, and they don't want to let go of it. But when you show an interest, and when you tell the Holy Spirit that you willingly wants to work with that problem to get rid of it, because you want to walk in a way that is good in the eyes of God, and you want to stop walking in your old ways, the Holy Spirit will start. The more you show an interest, the more the Holy Spirit will show you more. The more you show an interest, the more he will reveal more. The more you do, the more he is going to do. But if the Holy Spirit sees that you're not doing anything, he will keep convicting you, but he won't give you the next step and the next step and the next step, because these next steps come after you start taking steps. He's not going to show you the whole path. He's going to show you the next bit and then the next bit and the next bit. And you will only get to reveal what comes after only once you take the step. So never say to yourself, oh, I don't have enough money to start this business. Oh, I don't have enough knowledge to do this job. Oh, I don't have enough this to enter this relationship, or none of that. If the Holy Spirit is guiding you to do it, because most of the time he won't show you everything ahead of time. The more you take a step, the more he will reveal. So the key is to taking that step and trusting in the process. That's the key. So getting back to the issue I was talking about with anger, if anger is your issue, if you've willingly shown an interest to deal with the anger issue that the Holy Spirit has convicted you, then he will start showing you more and more things. He will start to show you in advance before you would lash out. Now he's going to start showing you in advance as the anger is boiling up. What's he doing? He's giving you a chance to change it. He's giving you a chance not to lash out and to do something different. He's giving you a chance. And once you take that step, then the Holy Spirit is going to take it even further. In other words, now he's going to start showing you things before it starts boiling up. It could be things like, don't take that path because that person's going to anger you. And you see, the more you do, the more the Holy Spirit is going to show you. And then the more you do, the more he's going to show you. And then he might take, and then when you start to obey, because he's also seen if you're going to be obedient, if you're going to obey, if he can trust you, and if you trust him to really not take that path that he's told you not to take. And if you obey and you don't take that path and you take a new path that he's told you, he will just keep showing you more and more and more until you reach a point where, guess what? The anger's just gone. I've won that battle. I've passed the test. I've purged that out. I've broken that slavery mindset of anger. And that's how that works. And that's just an example of anger. The issue could be a money issue. It could be a relationship issue. It could be a health issue. It could be anything. But that's the process that I've seen that it's starting to, that it works. And you have to trust. And then when you're not walking in these old ways anymore, God starts to bless you. Because remember, God doesn't bless sin. So the Holy Spirit is convicting you of this anger, but you say, I don't have time to work on that now. It's just easier for me to lash out in anger as opposed to be patient and work with the Holy Spirit. Guess what? God's not going to bless that. God doesn't bless him. And you say, well, why is not God blessing me? I've been praying so long for finances. I've been praying so long for a kingdom marriage. I've been praying so long for good help. I've been praying so long for this. Why is God not blessing me? God doesn't bless him. That's why. God doesn't bless him. Remember, I told you, somewhere in your mind, in your heart, in your house, there's sin. And I'm not saying you've got to get rid of sin all in one go. That's not what I'm saying. But God knows if you're making an effort to willingly work towards something he's He's guiding you toward. It could be that you're working on an anger issue, but God's seeing that you're being very, very obedient to him. While you're working in that anger issue, he could bless you with something that's got nothing to do with anger. Why? Because he sees that you're working on this sin. You're putting in the time, you're putting in the effort. Just because you're working on anger doesn't mean that he's only going to bless you in that field. Just because you're working on finances doesn't mean that he's only going to bless you in that field. If he sees that you're working, if he sees that you've got faith, if he sees that you're being obedient, that you're trusting him, he's going to bless you in other areas too. And so if there's no blessings happening, nothing's moving, somewhere there's blockage, is stuck somewhere, and it doesn't depend on God, it depends on you. You're not waiting on God, God is waiting on you. What am I going to title this video, by the way? What should I title this video? Let me come up with that later. So anyway, so the first step is Jesus Christ. If you have already accepted Jesus Christ, good, begin your walk, be obedient, follow the guidance of God. You always want to know, you always want to get closer to God, closer to God, closer to God. You always want to know what God wants you to do, what God wants you to do, what God wants you to do. And then you want to be obedient. Then you want to be obedient. God is going to break that mindset off you. God is going to remove those emotional attachments from you. God is going to help you stop walking in the ways of the world and in the ways of God. And it's all a process. It's all a process. It's a purging process. It's a yielding process. It's a testing process. It's a training process. It's all of that. These times, it could be a roller coaster. These times are not always comfortable. These times can be uncomfortable, but it's where God gets to test you. Do you really trust me? Do you really have patience? Are you really going to obey? Because if you're not going to trust, if you're not going to have patience, if he can't trust you in this little season, why would he take you further? If you can't handle this season in your life, why is he going to give you more, take you further, where you're going to encounter more difficult? Because the more he gives you, the more he requires of you. The less he gives you, the less he requires of you. If you can't handle this season to get through to the other side, why would he give you so much more if you won't be able to handle the things that come with the so much more? Think about that. So with that being said, there are links in the description below. Link to my book. You can get that from Amazon, paperback and Kindle. You can find the link to Sow to My Ministry, if that's what you want, and you can find the link to send me your prayer request, and I pray over all of you every Sunday. So until next time, God bless you, and may the peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. Amen.